Everyone has a story. Stories have power. They help us understand. Jessup's Journal is a collection of powerful, positive, and inspirational stories. It's time for Jessup's Journal.
Hi, I'm Doug Jessup. Welcome to this episode of Jessup's Journal, where we share powerful, positive, and inspirational stories. When was the last time you said thank you to someone? There's this phrase, deeds, not words. It's a great phrase, but let me add something. How about deeds and words? First off, I want to thank Brandy Vega and the Vega Media Studios for this new broadcast home. And yeah, the guy behind the camera, his name is Zach Berry. He's doing a good job. So we're going to dive in just a bit. We're going to talk about things that you're thankful for. And so sit back, relax, enjoy the show. Holidays are a funny thing. I mean, on the one hand, they can be joyous. And the other hand, let's get real, they can be a little stressful. But there was one holiday, Thanksgiving. Makes me wonder, why do we think about what we're thankful just one time a year? So here's a question I have for everyone out there right here, right now. What are you thankful for this very day, this very moment?
I'm thankful for like the beautiful nature and for the rain that's going on.
I'm really grateful for good health. I've had a period of bad health and it's just so nice to be healthy and be able to get out.
The beautiful weather.
Music.
I'm thankful for air conditioning.
I'm thankful for my mom.
It's time to pack your bags with the TV Travel Man. Let's see where we're going today. In this episode of Jessup's Journey, we're traveling at your leisure off the coast of California to Catalina Island. Upon arriving in the city of Avalon on Catalina Island, we got on a modified military Humvee and took a tour of the town of about 4,000 full-time residents with Andrew Quintana of the Catalina Island Company.
You can call me Andrew, Andy, Driver, Drew, You, Hey You, or Bison.
More about the name Bison later. The Wrigley family, yes, the chewing gum folks, acquired the majority of the Catalina Island Company in 1919, built a house and invested millions of dollars in the island. The Wrigleys happen to own a baseball team, so why not? Catalina Island was the spring training location for the Chicago Cubs from 1921 to 1951.
From the prom-fringed patio of the country club at Catalina Island, the National League champion Chicago Cubs leave for their nearby spring training grounds.
In the 1970s, the Wrigleys donated 88% of the land to the Catalina Island Conservancy for preservation. The island normally gets around 11 inches of rain per year. This year, they got more than double that number, which makes for an incredible, beautiful landscape.
Excellent. You're near 20 million people right now, because from Santa Barbara County...
The mountain road dates back to 1897. It was originally a 6-foot-wide dirt road for stagecoaches. Our Hummer was 8 feet wide, counting the mirrors. The island is home to plant life you won't find anywhere else. We stopped and checked out a special variety of rosemary that looks a lot like dill that grows along the trail. Incredible fragrance.
What you're going to do is you're going to crush it in your palm.
Our tour was touted as an eco-tourism ride. It's interesting to find out that the local restaurants donate their used cooking oil that's then converted into biofuel right there on the island and used to run the Hummers. Charlie Chaplin used to be a pilot that would fly his guests to the island.
Well, the island company, we do these tours out here that take us into areas where you can come across wild North American bison. They are scattered throughout this island. There's only about 100 roughly around that number out in the hills, and it's always kind of a roll of the dice. It's like whale watching. You can't promise them, but they are there sometimes. So when we come across them, people don't yell Andrew, they yell bison. And so kind of a nickname now.
Unfortunately, we didn't find any bison while we were on our Hummer ride, but we did find one at the airport.
Catalina Island, from Long Beach to Catalina Island, it's 26 miles, which is the same distance it would take to go from downtown LA to Disneyland. There's 20 million people in Southern California, and they're all on the freeway. But you come out here to the island, it's a different world.
Everyone has a story, but objects have stories too. We're gonna find out the story behind this, right here, this hat. Hint, it's called the George.
Music. My grandfather and I were very close. He died a long time ago. The last thing he said to my mother was, "Please remember me." And there's this song in this movie, Coco, that just says it all.
Until you're in my arms again, remember me.
My grandfather was George Ljungquist. He was born in 1903 to Swedish immigrant parents, Ida and Frederick. George had a good childhood in Southern California. He met a beautiful nursing student by the name of Florence. They got married in 1936. They had two lovely daughters, the oldest of which was my mother. Sadly, Florence died at the age of 43 of breast cancer. My mother was 14 years old. I was born 6 years later. Gramps was the kindest, most patient man I've ever known. He'd come up and we'd rub noses. He'd call them Eskimo kisses. Then we'd rub, you know, that 5 o'clock shadow. I knew I was loved. He always had a camera in his hand. He was always recording things. He had stories to tell. He even took pictures of a rare 1949 snowstorm in Pasadena. I follow in his footsteps, telling stories with pictures. He'd come to our house on Sundays a lot of the time for dinner. I'd take him around the rose garden at our house. I still grow roses to this day and think of him. Gramps was one sharp dresser. These cufflinks right here are actually his. I made him this custom hat. I call this hat the George. So Gramps, when you say, "Please remember me," I got you covered.
One of my favorite inspirational quotes is from Audrey Hepburn. She said, "To plant a garden is to believe in tomorrow."
Morning, John.
How you doing?
Excellent.
I'm Doug Jessup, TV Garden Guy. Today, I'm at Mill Creek Gardens.
Lorraine, the pansies are looking fantastic. Greenhouse number one, right?
That's our propagation house.
Let's go.
Okay, come on in and see all the cool stuff we have going in here. Right now, they're planting plugs, which come as little starts. These are 1-inch plugs, and in 4 weeks, they'll be ready to come out. This is Candy Tuft. It even has a nice fragrance to it, and next to it is my favorite lupin. And these lupin, once there's some water in them, you can see a little jewel right in the middle. In each greenhouse, there's usually 7,000 to 10,000, depending on what varieties there are. And in here, we just go and plant a tray at a time in waves.
From Mill Creek Gardens with Lorraine, I'm Doug Jessup, TV Garden Guy. Here's a group that deserves a big shout out. First responders. These are the people that when danger hits, they don't go back, they run forward. Chief Thomas, thanks for coming. It's time to sign into Jessup's Journal. In this episode of Jessup's Journal, I have Jeffrey James Thomas, or actually I should call you Chief, actually not even Chief, Battalion Chief Jeffrey James Thomas.
Well, you can just call me Jeff.
Jeff, right. Okay. Exactly. Now, we kind of teased a little bit in there, and you and I had talked earlier, and you were a man of stature, you were an imposing figure, and there was a little phrase that you and I talked about earlier saying gladiator. Call yourself a gladiator.
I'm currently a gladiator in the arena of the firefighting world, but back in the day, as we were discussing earlier, I arrived in Salt Lake City many years ago to perform as a gladiator in the Coliseum of the University of Utah playing football. So, I mean, I liken it to the Roman Coliseum because, you know, you have the gladiators out there battling, and that's mm-hmm. what we were doing. And now I battle for the city of Salt Lake.
So what position did you play when you were in football?
I played tight end at the University of Utah many years ago, and I've got the battle scars and bad knees to be thankful and grateful for.
Oh, yeah, well, you know, I always say life does come with scars, you know. How in the world does a kid go from being a football player to a firefighter?
Now, that's an interesting story, Doug. I actually followed in my brother's footsteps.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he retired as one of the top-ranking chief officers out of the city of San Jose, California. And one day I was back home visiting him, and at the time, he was his wife was a stay-at-home mom, and he was working hard. He had a side job, and I thought, with the hours that he's putting in versus the hours I'm putting in, I think this is something that I can do. As a child, I would always hang out at the fire station, and the firefighters would routinely, be welcoming. And so early on, I realized that, I think I could do that. And I think I would excel if given an opportunity to be a firefighter. And I really like to serve the community and be in a place where the young people and the young kids in the community can see me. And it's been a very rewarding career.
So how long have you been a firefighter?
You know, I've been a firefighter since 1987, so I've been at it for 33 years, going on 34, so it's been for a minute or two.
Well, thank you for your service.
Well, thank you.
Jeff, it seems to me like you're in a field where you got to be a little, I guess, wired a little differently is the polite way to put it, because you're going towards danger instead of away from danger. Do you remember the first fire that you actually, participated in?
I can remember the first what we call working fire, where we know that this is going to require a great deal of resources to deal with it. And I remember it vividly. It was just a few blocks south and east of here. It was a basement fire in which I was the nozzleman. I'm the first person through the door. Smoke-filled basement. We enter the basement doing what's called a left-hand search. Either you're going to go right or you're going to go left. You're going to grab a wall and try and follow that wall and maneuver around the obstacles as you proceed. And eventually I came to a 5x5 opening, like a box, right? A tunnel. So we proceeded down that tunnel because I could see the orange glow at the end of the tunnel. We sprayed for a while and it was still glowing. So we proceeded towards what we call the objective. I want to get closer to the seat of the fire. So me and two other guys behind me, we start proceeding down that tunnel in the basement of this apartment house, and we continue to spray, and next thing you know, I hear the muffled sounds of someone behind me. And remember, it's a 5x5 box. I'm on my hands and knees, and I'm able to turn just enough to see the glow behind us. So the fire had actually started behind us where we thought it was already out. And so I released the nozzle so the guy behind us could put it out. We ended up backing out through the fire. And that was my first experience, confined space and being in a precarious position.
So apparently you're not claustrophobic.
Actually, I am a little claustrophobic, but we go through a great deal of training, and the fire service gets you ready for whatever you're going to face.
A little birdie told me that Jeffrey James Thomas is also an actor. So tell me about that.
You know, I've started my acting career in the state of Utah all by happenstance. It's a small black community. A friend of mine, B. Murphy, he famously would sing at the jazz games and such. And he approached me and he says, Karl Malone needs some extras to help him with his new launch of his L.A. Gear tennis shoes.
Really?
And I'm working several side jobs at the time, and I asked, well, how much does it pay? And when he gave me the amount that the company was going to be paying, I thought, I could probably do this.
Did they pay you in tennis shoes?
No, they did not.
Did you get any of them?
I didn't get any shoes,
man.
But the work was fairly easy, and the pay was really, really, agreeable to me. So that's how I started, and shortly thereafter, I got an agent. I did two extra jobs, and after that, I told my agent, I don't think I want to do any more extra work, but I would be interested in some on-film talent stuff. And from that point forward, I've been acting in this market now for over 25 years and had some great opportunities.
Have you ever been cast as a firefighter?
You know, I have not. I've been cast
really?
As a police officer several times. But never as a fan. And I've auditioned for the role of the firefighter.
I'm just saying, you tell them you got the uniform, okay?
Yeah, right. And I think I know the lingo.
Yeah, exactly. Wow. Is there any particular thing that a homeowner can do to help keep their lives and their property safe?
Absolutely. But I think that the thing that you can do to prepare your family the most is to have the conversation, right? Mm-hmm. Have a difficult conversation, have an escape plan in place, and really just plan, right? Think, plan, and act. Talk about what are we going to do in the event of a fire? How do we get out of the house? Do we have gathering places established? Have you considered, you know, having to live outside of your home environment for over 72 hours? I mean, Katrina taught us that it may take a while for the cavalry to arrive. And if you think about New Orleans and where that took place, they were surrounded by resources. Whereas Salt Lake City being kind of the gateway to the west, it could be a while before the cavalry arrives. I used to tell my students, okay, it's 3 o'clock in the morning. We just got a fresh coat of snow outside, 10 inches of snow out on the lawn, and your house starts shaking violently. Now you have to get out with whatever you went to bed wearing, and now you're standing out in the snow, all the power's out in the neighborhood, and you look up and down, you realize, man, a lot of my neighbors managed to get out, and that's a beautiful thing. But in the meantime, you're standing in, you know, 8 or 10 inches of snow. You look back at your house, and unreinforced masonry, it's crumbled, it's ready to collapse.
Mm-hmm.
It's about that time when the youngest child in the family looks up at you and says, Daddy, I'm cold. What are you prepared to do? Are you prepared to live outside of that environment based on, you know, your plan or not? So disaster emergency planning for me is one of the biggest things, I think, or biggest takeaway that I would want everyone to consider in this interview is that, man, it is up to you. I mean, your life depends on your planning in this environment.
The question that I ask everybody is, and let me get into my broadcaster voice.
Okay.
Battalion Chief Jeffrey James Thomas, how do you want to leave your mark?
You know, that's a difficult question that I ponder. I mean, there's so many things that I would like to say, but I guess the mark that I want to leave is that I left this place better than I found it, and that I was able to raise three great citizens in our community, my children, my grandchildren, my family is my greatest legacy. Regardless of anything else I've done in this world, I believe that the human beings that I leave behind is my greatest treasure and joy.
Well said and agreed. A big shout out to the Layton Fire Department. They helped suit me up and they let me put out a fire. Layton in North Davis County is full of heroes. Jason Cook, Battalion Chief at the Layton Fire Department, wants to remind people that when it comes to fire safety, you can be a hero by having an escape plan and taking preventative measures.
Smoke detectors throughout, because notification and getting people out of the home is always going to be our number one priority.
Do you know how most home fires start?
Cooking fires.
What should you do?
Everybody's inclination is to put water on a fire, when in fact the very best thing, especially in that circumstance, we can do is smother the fire. A simple little thing like taking a pot cover and covering the fire safely, sliding across over where whatever may be burning, will quickly extinguish the fire in a matter of seconds.
What can you do to put me to work?
I think we should suit you up and have you go fight some fire with us tonight.
The Layton Fire Department took good care of me and helped me get all the protective gear on. I was amazed to learn that they get suited up in 45 seconds or less and get their breathing apparatus on and operating in another 45 seconds or less. Firefighter Shiloh Cromer gave me extra time. It's amazing to see what a difference fire sprinkler systems can make. I got to be part of the demonstration.
This one on the right is gonna burn for 4 to 6 minutes, the average national response time, versus if we see a sprinkler system, there's very moderate damage to the structure.
Have you ever wondered where your blood goes after you donate?
Every single day, there's 12 to 18 kids at Primary Children's waiting for blood. At University in Huntsman, there's another 40 to 50 patients every single day that need blood.
Ann Harvey at Primary Children's Hospital told us about one of those kids.
He has a condition called beta thalassemia. So for someone Garrett's size, we need at least two people every single month for his whole entire life to donate.
Meet Garrett Thorell and his mom, Rachel.
Every 3 to 4 weeks, I go up to the hospital and see the doctors and stuff.
there waiting for the blood to come and they hooked me up.
Every 3 to 4 weeks, if somebody doesn't give blood, my son wouldn't be with us.
Garrett is an active kid that did his best to teach me a new dance.
Take a stick.
Break
a stick.
He also loves soccer.
Every time I watch him play soccer, run with the little neighbor boys and play games, I know that he is alive because of the generosity of somebody.
Do you have time to donate blood? Families like the Thorells sure hope so.
Yeah.
People understand that huge correlation with donating.
You should donate blood for other people to help other people so they can spend more time with their family.
Spend more time with their sisters?
Yeah, no.
These stories deserve to be told. These are caring stories. I'm Doug Jessup.
This hat right here, it's called a straw boater. Now, this is from the 1920s. Nowadays, you see them on barbershop quartets. There was a gentleman that was a good family friend and also one heck of a great engineer. He just also happened to be a good singer, too. Go figure. So he's our musical guest. It's a tribute to Mr. Dean Davidson.
Singing loud for all to hear. Joining us today is the North Front Sound Men's a cappella group. Lighten Up. They've been on the show before, but this is my favorite time of year to have you gentlemen because it just puts me in the mood for the holidays. Welcome back.
Thank you. Thank you. Glad to be here.
Glenn, tell everyone how this got started.
Well, so North Front Sound is a barbershop course that actually got started in a garage in Kaysville with about 10 people, and that was in about 2014. And so since then, the group has just gotten bigger. We love singing barbershop. We love recruiting, getting anyone we can.
Describe barbershop, Bruce, for people that aren't familiar with it.
Well, barbershop is basically four-part men a cappella harmony. Usually people will pick their part. Glenn sings the lead, I sing tenor, Dean sings bass, and John Lee sings everything else, so baritone. And usually the songs are usually fairly simple, but they go back to the old shave and a haircut type of, that's what I call it, barbershop. You know, and so that's basically what it is, four-part men's a cappella, close harmonies, and then you really like to hear that resonance, and it's really quite difficult, but it's just so much fun. We've been doing this for a while.
Dean works with all of us here at ABC4. I had no idea you had such an incredible voice. Why did you want to be part of the group, Dean?
Well, it's the biggest part is it's a lot of fun. I mean, we have a blast singing together. And we have this big group of guys that are
amazing
fun to
guys.
Hang. Yeah, amazing guys that are fun to hang out with.
Were and you we, friends to
we
begin
sing.
With?
Not really.
Like all four of us met at the chorus.
Yeah.
You know, I found it. I moved to the area and just looked online, and it's one of the chapters of the Barbershop Harmony Society. So I thought, well, I haven't sung barbershop in a while. Found it, started going, and met up with this great group.
Because, John, you all have day jobs. What's yours?
I'm actually a dentist in Clinton.
Are you really?
Yeah.
And, Dean, I know where you work.
Yeah.
Bruce, what about you?
No, I work as a handyman, actually, all over Davis and Weber County.
Okay, and Glenn?
I'm a therapist.
Are you really?
Yep, mental health therapist, so.
Okay, how does this help your mental health, gentlemen? Is singing good for the soul?
It really is, and they've done scientific studies. When it comes to singing, it works with so many endorphins. You use several parts of your brain, so I've got to remember the words, I've got to remember my notes, I've got to be in sync, you know, with my fellows here.
Okay, what happens when you're not in sync? Do you give each other a look?
Sounds bad.
A crusty, yeah.
A crusty look.
A crusty look.
You know, like you're not doing well here.
Usually
sometimes we stop, you know, we might have to restart.
Sometimes. Usually if Glenn gets off, then we just kind of have to follow him because he's the lead.
Is it Glenn that gets off the most?
Well, no. He's usually always on unless he forgets the words. He's got
it's
one
true.
Job.
I've got to remember the words.
Can you show me? Can you sing? Like, I want to hear each of your, like, voices come in one by one, maybe with the Good Things Utah theme?
Sure. And,
okay.
And so you'll notice John Lee's using a little pitch pipe, so that gets us all on the right key. So he's going to play a C.
All right, John.
There we go. See, words. I got to remember the words.
Okay.
You're
watching Good Things Utah on ABC Channel 4.
You each have these amazing individual voices, but when they all come together, it's magic.
Mm-hmm. And that is the magic of barbershop, is that each part is so important that, you know, we rehearse sometimes, and every once in a while, if one of us can't make it, we'll still try and rehearse, but it's like, wait, something's wrong.
It's not the same.
Yeah.
What a day this has been, what a rare mood I'm in, why it's almost like being in love. There's a smile on my face for the whole human race, why it's almost like being in love. Oh, the music of life seems to be like a bell that is ringing for me. And from the way that I feel when that bell starts to peal, I could swear I was falling, I could swear I was falling. It's almost like being in love. Oh, the music of life seems to be like a bell that is ringing for me. And from the way that I feel when that bell starts to peal, I could swear I was falling, I could swear I was falling. It's almost like being in love, it's almost like being in love, in love. Let me call you sweetheart, I'm in love with you. Let me hear you whisper that you love me too. Keep the love light glowing in your eyes so true. Let me call you sweetheart, I'm in love with you, with you.
What makes you smile? Spry Natural Xylitol Gum makes me smile. I think it might help you too.
Thanks for watching this episode of Jessup's Journal, where we share powerful, positive, and inspirational stories and music. Everyone has a story. Yes, you have a story. Stories have power. They help us understand each other. With another entry into Jessup's Journal, I'm Doug Jessup.
Let me hear you whisper that you love me too. Keep the love light glowing in your eyes so true. Let me call you sweetheart, I'm in love.